Episcopal Church, and thank you to Mary Ann for inviting me here. It is delightful to be with you this morning. I am a deacon to my core. I have a couple of other hats that I wear at the diocese, but deacon's the one that I claim first. You may wonder what a deacon is, but you've had some great models of what deacons are, and we're getting another one in a few weeks with the newly ordained Greg Ramey. But one of my roles that I play at the diocese is I'm the archdeacon, glorified coordinator of deacons. And so when I show up somewhere, I want to tell you a little bit about deacons just because that's part of what I do. So you may think that deacons are the folks who serve. They are called to serve and feed the hungry and free the prisoner. And while that is true, it's not the full truth, because if you have been a baptized Episcopalian, that is actually your job. You all are called to seek and serve Christ in all people and respect the dignity of every human being, strive for justice, all of those things. Deacons do that too. But we also help you do that part of your ministry. So as baptized Christians, we are all called to seek and serve Christ, to feed the hungry, and free the prisoner, and preach God's dream into this sometimes crummy human world we have. Deacons sometimes are called a mobilizer and motivate everybody else to do their ministry. And as archdeacon, I get to work with the deacons to do that. So I get to help equip the deacons to go help equip everyone else. And I love that part of my job. I got hooked into being a deacon myself when my parish priest used an analogy. He said, if deacons had a motto, it would be that they could comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. And I thought, I am good at that. Particularly the afflicting part. So that was when I started to hear a call from God to be in the church, when I realized that I was a priest. To be clear, God calls all of us to do something. Teacher, parent, priest, deacon, doesn't matter. And it always troubles me a little bit when you think about people. The only people who are called are the ones who get ordained. That is wrong. Just wrong. So we are all called by God. Deacons have a specific ministry to help equip everybody else to get out there and do your baptismal ministry. Deacons are also a bridge between the church and the world. With one, some say, one foot in the church and one foot in the world. And the roles that deacons play on Sunday morning are very iconic of our role in the what we are called to be as deacons. We preach the gospel. We are the prophetic voice trying to evoke God's vision of the way that we should be in this world. We are involved in the prayers of people, bringing forth the concerns and needs of the world into this place. We serve, we set the table and help with the Eucharist. And we also get the people in the church out into the world by being the ones who do business at the end of service. So they seem kind of random, but they all are very iconic. And every one of those jobs when I get to do them is just an honor, because it's so clearly tied up to what I believe I'm called to do. So the other two pieces of my day job that I do for the diocese is I am the archdeacon. Love that involvement with the rest of the beautiful community of deacons we have in Western Oregon. And for the past year, I have also taken a job and I work directly for Bishop Hanley. And one of those, I have a lot of other duties as assigned, but one of the biggest that I really like is I'm the vocations coordinator, which means when folks are pursuing a specific call by God to possibly be ordained, I'm the one who helps them navigate that sometimes torturous path. So I mention all of that for a couple of reasons. First of all, I think there is always the risk of deacons being misunderstood. We don't barely understand what we do ourselves, so it's no wonder that the rest of the church struggles sometimes. So that's right now the understanding of deacons. Mobilize, motivate, help everybody else do their ministry. I think that it is also indicative of how I see Scripture and how I understand Scripture. It's so if you are anywhere around, think that you might understand that you might have a call from God to be working, now you know someone you can check in with and see how to navigate that sometimes tortuous route. So now back to the scripture. So today's gospel story, we hear yet another healing story from Jesus. Luke's gospel is full of them. You've got a lot of, Jesus can give a lot of healing. Jesus is in the temple, and a woman comes by, and she has been afflicted by a spirit for 18 years, and doubled over, unable to stand up straight. Jesus calls her over and heals her. And she stands up straight and praises God. A couple of interesting things about that healing story that are not the same as the rest of the healing stories we hear about. First of all, it's two-part. So normally, Jesus says, you're healed, and that's the end of the story. You're healed. In this story, you are healed, yes. God spoke the planets into being. All creation happens with God's speech. And then in this instance, Jesus says, you are healed. And then he goes over and he touches her. And upon that touch, that's when she stands up straight and praises God. So there is this magical, holy, divine moment of God speaking healing. You are healed. And then there is this very human moment of Jesus coming over and touching her, and that's when she's healed. That is pretty unique in this story. There are a couple of other instances in healing stories where Jesus talks about touching someone and healing them. Mostly it's just verbal. You are healed. And planets come into being and people are healed. When Jesus touches, it's generally to someone who is unclean or otherwise dismissed by society. So it is a big deal that this story includes this moment of touch, that Jesus is touching an unclean person, risking the rest of the world thinking he is now unclean as well by a personal touch. So that's a pretty intriguing component of the story. The other part that is interesting is that she didn't ask for it. She didn't say, Jesus, come heal me, help me. We don't know anything about her. He just called her over and healed her. So that's interesting to me, because how many times do we see people who don't bother asking for help? And we don't even know if she was a faith-fearing, God-loving person. Jesus didn't care. Jesus healed her, and her response was she stood up and praised God. So it was apparently the right thing to do. But there are so many instances of people and groups and incident circumstances when if they don't ask or they're not worthy, we don't engage, we don't heal, we don't share God's love. And Jesus didn't care about anything. He didn't check her membership. He didn't make sure that she was worthy. He healed her, and he touched her, and she was made well. So there's something in there about not needing an invitation. We just didn't wait for her to ask. And we, as God's agents on this earth, don't necessarily need to wait to see somebody's membership, to see if they're worthy of giving. We need to be ready to share God's love with everybody. Respect the dignity of every human being. Every human being. So that's this lovely healing story. You can walk away with a warm and fuzzy feeling about God's healing. Except then the story continues, and we get these pesky church leaders who are mad that he healed on the Sabbath. And it is pretty easy for Jesus to dismiss that argument and say, you would untie your animals and you would give them water on the Sabbath. Why can't I heal this woman? Are you suggesting that she's somehow less worthy than your animals? And it's easy for us now, thousands of years later, to shake our finger at those same church leaders and think how silly they are to think that Jesus can't do that at that moment. Yeah, except we kind of do that too, don't we? So we also have the right way we think things ought to be, and sometimes loving God and loving our neighbor is not as important as is the way things should be. The religious leaders in this story are trying to support what they understand to be one of those big Ten Commandments. But the way they did it, they usurped what they were trying to do, undergirding all of that, love God, love your neighbor. So what is it in our world that we think we should be doing or we shouldn't be doing that could be getting in the way of what it is we really should be doing? So some people have special prayer practices or disciplines. Fasting during Lent is a good example. Or not eating meat, or keeping the Sabbath holy and not doing any healing, for example. Anything that we do that gets between us and loving God and loving neighbor, it isn't serving your purpose anymore. You need to like think about it. If ever it doesn't feel like you're loving, probably not really a useful practice anymore. As Michael Curry has said, if it's not about love, it's not about God. So your prayer practices, your disciplines are really great as long as they help you stay connected to God. And when they become the means to the end, they become the end of itself, then you gotta